that gigolo on the street with his hands in his pockets and his crocodile feet hanging off the curb, looking on search at the boys from home. They all came running, they were making noise, manhandling toys. That's the girls on the block with the nasty curls, wearing padded bras, sucking beer through straws, dropping down their drawers. Where did you get yours?
Good evening and welcome to another exciting edition of Platter Chatter, the music review show that critiques and analyzes music that's on the cutting edge of today's scene. I'm Scott Goldfine, music critic for Inside Music and Video.
And my name is Malissia Simpson, and we want to welcome you to Platter Chatter, and we hope that you're having a nice day. We've got some really interesting music for you. We're going to be listening to the Red Hot Chili Peppers and one of Scott's all-time favorite bands, none other than Mr.
George Clinton. Of course, he's a band unto himself, isn't he? Yeah, Red Hot Chili Peppers album called Mother's Milk, George Clinton, Cinderella Theory, and finally, we're going to wrap it up with
Pump by Aerosmith.
That's right. So let's get right in with Red Hot Chili Peppers, Melissa. Okay. What do you think?
Well, they've got a new album out, and we're going to be listening to a cutoff of it. It's called Good Time Boys. We're going to go right to it, and we'll be back. Check it out. You were listening to the Red Hot Chili Peppers. This is their third album. The last one was called Uplift Mofo Party Plan. And this is a cutoff of their new album. Scott, what do you think about this? Personally, I think that it's just a little more serious than their last album.
Well, they have reason to be serious, seeing as how their guitar player, Hilo Slovak from Israel, OD'd on heroin last year. They were getting ready to go on. The day before they went in the studio, he OD'd. So that put a damper on things, and they regrouped. They got it back together. They got a new drummer also. The old drummer, Jack Irons, left in the wake of Slovak's death. And they got a new guitar player named John
Frusciante.
Right. And a new drummer as well named Chad Smith. So they've regrouped, and interestingly enough, they've got the same producer, Michael Bainhorn, that worked on the last album. And the sound really isn't all that different, although, as you say, maybe it is more serious.
Well, I think so. We're going to listen to another cut off of the album. It's called Knock Me Down. Here we go.
Okay, welcome back to the studio. We're listening to the Red Hot Chili Peppers and Mother's Milk. That cut was called Knock Me Down. That is their first single and video from the album. And it's kind of in response to their guitar player ODing. It's, you know, about not doing drugs and that kind of thing.
Exactly. And this is, this I think is one of the better songs on the album. They have another cut on there called nobody weird like me, and it's a weird song.
Well, there's plenty of weird songs. There's all kinds of stuff on there. I mean, it's a venerable hodgepodge of all kinds of stuff. I mean, they use punk, rap, rock, funk, all kinds of stylings. They even have an ode to the Lakers star guard Magic Johnson, called right. Magic Johnson, exactly. Which is kind of amusing. And they have a cover of Stevie Wonder's classic Higher Ground.
How do you like that?
Well, you know, I'm so attached to the original, it's tough. But it's an interesting, you know, approach to it. And what I do like is that so many people have redone Superstition. It's interesting to hear someone redo one of Stevie's other good songs.
Well, I'm going to give this album a rating on a scale of 1 to 4, 4 being the highest. I'm going to give it a 2.5 because there are a couple of songs. Knock Me Down is absolutely my favorite. But I'm just not funky enough, I guess, and I can't quite get into them yet. But they do have some good music, and their playing is okay, and, you know.
Well, what's great about the Chili Peppers is they don't sell out. You know, this is their fourth album, and the sound has pretty much remained the same. And, I mean, if you like that raw edge sound, you know, it's really cool. And, I mean, they take Hendrix and Funkadelic and punk influences and put it all together, and it's a very neat little package. And I think this album is just about as good as any of them, and I'm going to give it a rating of 3 discs.
One thing I will say about them is that some of the music almost sounds like it's going back to the 60s. You know, some of it is kind of tinny in a way, but it's a nice, strong 60s beat, and there is definitely a Funkadelic influence in it. I mean, you can hear it all the way through. Some parts of it, I think, he funks even harder than George Clinton, if that's possible.
Well, and that's a perfect lead into our next album, because especially since George Clinton produced the Chili Peppers' second album, Freaky Styly, you know, because they were playing and people were saying, you know, you guys sound like Funkadelic, and they're going, who? They're going, Funkadelic, and then they played Funkadelic stuff for him. As the story goes, I find it hard to believe that they never heard Funkadelic.
Yeah,
but
you never know.
But they played it for him, and they dug it, and they hooked up with George, and he did the album. And that's our next review, George Clinton's new album called The Cinderella Theory. This is his first album in over 3 years, and his first on Prince's label, Paisley Park.
It's called...
The first track we're going to listen to, and we're going to see the video as well, Why Should I Dog You Out?
Shake a few rumps and then you sold out. We did all of that without selling out. Not to be confused with.
I can pass it on.
be confused with wieners. Police dog. Not to be confused with deputy dog. Death dog. Not to be confused with hush puppies. Chilling out in the doghouse. Not to be confused with chili dogs. Boy, dog. Not to be confused with bitch.
Hey, that was Why Should I Dog You Out by George Clinton. You know, this is like a rehash almost of a song that he did in 1983 on the Atomic Dog album. And after seeing it, I really didn't like it. But now after seeing the video again, maybe that's why he did it again. Just because, you know, he could do this video and put all these things in it. I mean, it's more animated, but...
Well, the Atomic Dog video from '82, which this is really a sequel to, was an awesome video. It was a terrific video.
Right.
And by any standards, especially at that time, one of the best videos up until that point. But yeah, this is a rehash of Dog Talk. Was actually like a sequel to Atomic Dog, which had rapping in it. And it was under the name of the K-9 Crew. But this is just a little too derivative for me. I mean, it's not, you know, you expect George Clinton to be just so innovative, especially after a three-year hiatus. His last album, R&B Skeletons in the Closet, was really hot. Was really happening.
Scott, this is your man. You're into George.
Well, so who better to say that George seems a little laid back. Of course, he's missing some of the key musicians. This does have Bootsy Collins. But he's without people like Bernie Worrell and Eddie Hazel
and Wesley.
The Horny Horns.
I don't know. We're going to listen to another one off of this album. The Cinderella Theory is the name of the album. The song is called Tweakin'.
Just when I reached the point where I stopped the end, about all the time, imagination got to begin. That's when I heard it was in the start to begin.
Speaking in drums, joining into a tweet.
All right, we're funking you out with George Clinton. That was Tweakin'. And a little later in that track, Public Enemy members Flavor Flav and Chuck D come in, and they do the rapping thing because they've said, as so many rappers and just musicians in general, especially black musicians, tribute George Clinton as being one of the primary influences in their development with music.
A lot of white musicians are doing the same thing.
Oh, yeah, especially with Funkadelic and stuff. And speaking of Funkadelic, on the next show, hopefully we may have that because their long-awaited album, after 9 years or whatever, is supposed to finally come out. Their single's already out, and it's kind of a hot groove.
I believe it when I see it.
Well, you're going to see it.
I don't know. They do also a remake of the Banana Boat song on this album, and that's really kind of interesting. George doesn't do covers very often.
This is the first cover. It's actually the only cover that I can think of offhand that they've done. I mean, a lot of times they'll throw in little snippets of old songs and nursery rhymes and stuff like that in their music to do crazy types of things. But this is the first time of an actual cover of the old Harry Belafonte song, which was, you know, revitalized last year in Beetlejuice. Mm-hmm. But this still is kind of pop. It's kind of popish. It's not as, you know, as zany or crazy as I would hope for them to do.
Well, maybe because the Horny Horns and Bernie and Fred and the whole group were missing. It's really not, maybe George is just, you know, getting older and he's laying back and letting everybody else funk out for him. I don't know. Personally, this is not my favorite album. I can't really say that I'm a big funk fan. Those of you that have been watching the show know that I'm more pop-oriented, and Scott is seriously into the funk, so I'm going to rate this album, and I'm going to give it a 2. I dig you, George. You're cool, but I don't know.
Well, I think also, of course, George is like, you know, a musical god, but I'm just going to give it 2 discs also. I'm pretty disappointed.
Ah!
And, you know, I was expecting something more cutting edge, at least for there to be something, you know, more substantially on there as far as grooving goes. Seems like he's gone from making just the best grooves on the planet to being just kind of quirky, you know, and it's just, you know, the appeal now is just kind of quirkiness, and it's different from other stuff, but it's not really as...
Well, this song, Why Should I Dog You Out, in a way it seems like what he's saying is that, you know, why should I change or sell out and go pop or whatever just to make money, because this is where I'm at. So, you know, maybe that's what he's doing. Maybe
well,
he's
that's
just
his
laying
whole
back
thing, but
anymore.
That's one of the coolest things about him is that he will never sell. As we were saying earlier, he looks like the funk gladiator there, and that's what he does. He's like a superhero fighting for funk to go on forever and not to wash it out, not to sell it out. And he's a great guy, and I'm hoping that Funkadelic will be better, and I'm looking forward to the upcoming concerts he's doing.
Maybe when we see the concert, we'll be able to tell you just how funky he really did get live. Anyway,
yeah.
We're going to do Aerosmith. They got a new album, and it's called Pump.
That's right. This is their first album in 2 years, following up the multi-platinum Permanent Vacation, which was quite a comeback for them.
Absolutely.
And which after they, you know, they disbanded and all that, and they went through, you know, drug and alcohol problems and all this.
Rehab and all this.
But now they're cleaned out, and they're back on top commercially, and let's check out the first cut. It is called...
Love in an Elevator. Here we go. Love in an Elevator by Aerosmith. As I understand it, this song is based on an actual incident. We can't get rude and tell you exactly where or what happened, but we'll kind of let you figure out. Is that true, Scott?
Well, that's, you know, rumor has it that that's what it was. But with those crazy zany boys from Aerosmith, you can never be too sure.
Ah.
But anyway, musically speaking, that's their first single, of course, and it is... you know, zooming up the pop charts.
Absolutely.
And, you know, it's funny about Aerosmith because they started out and they're this hard blues-based rock band, kind of a harder version of the Rolling Stones. And they have come back, and they're, you know, groups like Bon Jovi and all these groups that are big now say they were their influence, Guns N' Roses and stuff. But those groups have been kind of pop rock groups.
Exactly.
And now Aerosmith, who was a mentor for those guys, comes back and they're getting big, and they're kind of like taking on influence of Bon Jovi and groups like that and becoming more pop-oriented. And all of a sudden they're a singles act after they never used to hardly have any hit singles.
Yeah, but look what happened. I mean, Run DMC, you know, did their song over with Aerosmith on it. That's a classic song, and it was pop, you know, it was popish.
Well, that song was a pop hit just by virtue of it being so catchy. But it certainly had a rougher edge to it in sound than something like Love in an Elevator or Dude Looks Like a Lady or Ragdoll or Angel or hits from last year and the year before. But this one, you know, I like the rougher edge. There's some tracks on this album that have the rougher edge, but there's certainly plenty of pop fare on this album.
Well, there's pop fare on it, but I have to agree with you. I think this is rougher, more... rock oriented, you know, I mean, it's pop influence, but to me it's more rock oriented than their last album. The But the last album was a little bit funkier.
Really?
Yeah, but we're going to listen to...
You got an air guitar over there?
I'm a great air guitarist. We're going to listen to another cut off the album. It's called Don't Get Mad,
Get Even.
Aerosmith.
Rocking out, a little change of pace. We try to give you variety on the show, from the cutting edge of the Chili Peppers to the funk of Clinton to the hard rock of Aerosmith. That was called Don't Get Mad, Get Even, and I guess that's an adage that the boys advocate. I like that one. That's one of my favorites on the album because it's got that bluesy kind of Cajun bayou type feel to it that is so indicative of Aerosmith and what you think of when you think of them.
Well, my two favorite cuts on this album are Young Lust, which is the first cut off of the album, and Love in an Elevator, for whatever reason. This album, though...
Personal experience, Melissa?
Well, I know, Scott. Moi? Never. Well, but this album, I think, as I said, I think it's got a more rock edge. Their last album, I think, was a lot more funkier. The guitar licks on Permanent Vacation weren't as strong to me as they are on this one. No, it was more funkier. It was, in some ways, I think it was, there were a couple of songs that were like country rock.
Well, this album also produced by Bruce Fairbairn, who did their last album, and he's also Bon Jovi's producer. So there is that kind of connection there. Although I will never say Aerosmith sinks to a Bon Jovi level, there's a little of that pop rock sound in there. And unfortunately for me, this album doesn't quite come through with that big punch, that big injection of Aerosmith crushing riffs, you know?
Well, so how are you going to rate it?
The 1 to 4 discs, 4 being best, I'm going to give Aerosmith Pump 2 discs.
Pump 2? Aerosmith, I never used to be into rock at all, and I've been kind of a convert from their last album. I'm going to give this rating. I know this is going to shock you. I'm going to give this rating a 4 because I think it's a pretty decent album. Although I don't think it's as strong as Permanent Vacation, that was more pop oriented to me, but I'm still going to give it a 4 because there's some songs in here that I think are really great.
Permanent Vacation was great. I would give that at least a 3.
Absolutely.
Okay, we're going to move on to some topics here in our closing minutes. Some important things coming up. Let's just touch on these real briefly, kind of maybe a thumbs up, thumbs down type thing. Although we don't want to copy any other TV shows. Stadium tours, reunion tours. The Stones, The Who, these bands are coming back.
Paul McCartney.
And, well, no, not so much Paul McCartney. I'm talking about the ones that are doing the stadiums, the huge stadiums. I'm against that. I think that the Stones, for instance, who have not toured since 81, when I saw them at the Coliseum locally here in L.A., they come back and they're again in stadiums. I think it's a ripoff to the fans. I think... you know, this generation is not going to have a chance to see the Stones in a decent environment. Why even bother? Same with The Who. The Who charges a fortune for tickets, and they play stadiums. They're only doing it for the money. It's not artistic, and I say thumbs down to those guys.
Well, Scott, I don't know how I feel about that one way or the other. Personally, I don't really care whether they play in a stadium or the Forum. You know?
You want to pay $30 to go sit between behind 70,000 people in a big stadium and see little tiny ants on the stage and crummy sound?
No, not really. But, you know, they're trying to cram in as many people to see them as they can. So.
Okay, well, thumbs up or down, because we got to go to the next topic.
Down.
Okay. One more thing, thumbs down on for me is the use of music, pop music, in commercials nowadays. Songs like, you know, people like Steve Winwood and stuff like that, using original songs that were not made for commercials, popular music on commercials, is bad because the music was not intended, in my opinion, music was not intended for that use, and it's exploiting and bastardizing the music.
Well, what they're doing is they're making megabucks, and that seems to be the whole deal, is making money.
Thumbs up or down?
Well, thumbs down.
Okay, you know, it's fine for pop artists to do these commercials, but I think that they should do original songs for it.
Well, another topic we're going to bring up is sampling. Personally, for me, I don't like sampling at all. I don't think it's necessary. I think if artists are going to do music, you got to do your own stuff. Quit sampling.
Okay, I also thumbs down on oversampling. It's got to be used in very much moderation. We're going to wind it up and say on the next show, look out for works by Funkadelic, Janet Jackson, and George Clinton's son is going to be doing something.
Yep, and once again, if you're out there listening, pick up the phone, write a postcard, say nasty things if you want. Just let us know that you're out there watching.
Well, preferably nice things.
Hopefully, and we're going to say adios, amigos.
Good night.
Bye.